Good morning to everybody. My name is Paolo Rosio, and today I want to talk with you about some chemical physical parameters crucial for proton NMR relaxation in the case of iron oxide co-shell nanoparticles. Today the focus is magnetic nanoparticles and their characteristics like composition, size, shape, coating, and functionalization, and also some external parameters like temperature, solution, and external magnetic applied field that can influence the NMR relaxometry of the magnetic nanoparticles, in particular in view of their application in magnetic resonance imaging. The magnetic nanoparticles are constituted by a magnetic part, normally simple ferrites or ferrites doped with different metallic ions, and an organic part that is crucial to allow the magnetic nanoparticle to become biocompatible. Which kind of magnetic nanoparticles can be synthesized? Here I reported some example of which kind of nanoparticles can be synthesized, but today I want to focus on the easiest magnetic nanoparticles, the core shell one. And in particular, if we take a look at the nanoscale, the magnetism of nanomaterials can be changed dramatically if we are able to produce magnetic nanomaterials with a proper size, depending obviously on which type of ions we decided to use. What we can obtain is this situation where all the electronic spins of the materials are aligned along the same direction, so we can obtain a giant spin for the nanoparticles. In the case that the magnetic anisotropy energy is comparable to the thermal energy, we observe the so-called phenomenon of superparamagnetism, where we have a material that behaves like a paramagnet, but with a really high magnetization, so like a ferromagnet. In the easiest case of the core shell nanoparticles, we have an easy magnetism, in the sense that we have only one easy axis for the magnetic anisotropy, and we have only two energetic minima. And so we can imagine that there is an inversion of our magnetization through an energetic barrier that is characterized by the magnetic anisotropy and the dimension of the nanoparticles. And this movement can be described by the nil correlation time. This situation can be implemented for interacting nanoparticles, adding a term that takes into account the interaction between nanoparticles. This picture is true for the case where we don't have yet applied an external magnetic field. But as soon as we apply an external field, the configuration of the energetic minima changes dramatically, and so the situation becomes more complex. But not only, we can manage the situation of so with temperature, for instance, going down to the temperature, we are able to lock the spin and reopen the hysteresis loop. But also, in the case of biomedical application, normally the magnetic nanoparticles are dispersed in solvent, so we have to take into account also the Brownian contribution, so the contribution of the to the relaxation due to the entire movement of the entire nanoparticle. So I hope that these slides show you how in macroscopic conditions and magnetic nanoparticles microscopic parameters can influence strongly their physical properties. Let's move to understand how magnetic nanoparticles can act as T2 negative contrast agents in MRI. If we observe the MRI signal, we see immediately that the signal depends on the proton density of the body tissues, depends on the magnetic susceptibility of the tissue, and depends on the nuclear relaxation times that are typical for each tissue. But not only, because The contrast in the image can depend also on some extrinsic parameters, like the intensity of the magnetic field, the type of RF path sequence used in the acquisition of the image, and can depend on the contrast agents, because they can act to change the nuclear relaxation times. So, in the case of the magnetic nanoparticles, the changes of the dipolar local field of the nanoparticles can induce, through an hyperfine interaction, a relaxation, a different relaxation of our local probe that are the protons of the water molecules that pass near the nanoparticles. So, if we study NMR experimental parameters like spectrum, spin-spin nuclear relaxation time T2 and nuclear spin lattice relaxation time T1, we can study the local magnetic field induced by the nanoparticles and the spin dynamics of our nanoparticles. In particular, for the MRI application, is important to evaluate the efficiency of nanoparticles as contrast agents through the nuclear relaxivity that represent the increase of nuclear relaxation rate of hydrogen nuclei in presence of 1 millimolar magnetic center. How we can study deeply the relaxation properties of the nanoparticles? We can study them through the nuclear magnetic resonance dispersion profile. An example is reported here, where the proton relaxivities are studied in function of proton armor frequency, or if you prefer, in function of the magnetic applied field. So, if we study this kind of profile, we are able to extrapolate many important information and characteristics of the magnetic properties of the nanomaterials. In particular, if we consider spherical magnetic nanoparticles non-interacting and well dispersed, and below 20 nanometers, Rock and others propose analytic model and after heuristic approximate expression that can describe these profiles. I don't want to go deep in details in the model, but I want to show you that from this model we can obtain some information regarding the distance of minimum approach of the water molecules near the nanoparticles, some important magnetic characteristics of the nanoparticle like anisotropy, nil time, correlation time, magnetization, and so on. So the theoretical models predict that the profiles depend on the type and dimension of the nanoparticles, depends on the nil relaxation time, depends on the magnetization of the nanoparticles, and predicts that at low field, R1 and R2 are coincident. Starting from these evidences, we study many types of magnetic nanoparticles experimentally, by experimental point of view. So we obtain the relaxivity profiles starting from R1 profiles. In this case, we study R1 profiles of magnetite nanoparticles coated in different ways, and we started to demonstrate that also experimental data confirmed the prediction of the models that the relaxation properties, R1 relaxation property, depends on the magnetic dimension. But not only. We tested also the model on our experimental data, fitting our data, and we obtained many information regarding the magnetization reversal of our nanoparticles, regarding the distance of minimum approach, and regarding the quantitative idea of a magnetic anisotropy of our nanoparticles. Passing some years, we obtain for the first time the complete experimental profiles of R2 also. In this case, we obtain these profiles for, again, magnetite particles, but doped with nickel and cobalt at a different quantity, as you can see here, but with the same coating. So, what we observe is that the relaxation properties depends strongly on the magnetic ions, on the type of magnetic ions. But what we obtain is that if we use the parameters obtained through the fitting procedure on R1 profiles, and we use the same parameters in the equation of the model for R2, we are not to fit our experimental data, as you can see in all these figures. So we cannot use the same fitting parameters for L1 and R2 profiles. We did the same work also on magnemite, a different type of magnetic ion, with different size of the nanoparticles, and we obtained that again the relaxation properties depends on the magnetic ion and core dimension, but again we failed to fit our experimental data using the same parameters for R1 and R2. In the same years, we studied also the effect of the shape and dispersant on the relaxation properties on other types of nanoparticles, always magnemite, but other types and other dimensions of nanoparticles, and we observed that there is an influence on the relaxation properties depending on the shape. In fact, we passing from spherical shape to cubic shape for this kind of nanoparticles, we observe a decrease of the relaxivities, but we observe also that for the dispersant the situation is more complex, because on one side R1 dramatically goes down if we pass from hexane to water dispersant. On the other side, for R2, the situation is completely the opposite, as you can see here. And so many studies probably must be necessary to try to understand this situation. And in the last years, we started to study the coating effect of magnetic nanoparticles. We started with magnemite nanoparticles of 17 and 18 nanometers, coated with different polar electrolytes, as you can see here. And for the moment, we observed that there is no evident effect produced by the different coatings. But another question is to be noted in the fact is that probably the coating effect can be seen only on the counted surface spin. So we need to go to a region of dimension, a smaller dimension region, to start to observe the effect of the coating, because only in that region the quantity of the counted spin become important with respect to the interior spin. So we can say some final comments. Nowadays we can say ferrite synthesis is well controlled, and we can obtain very different type of nanoparticles. We can affirm that we have demonstrated that magnetic properties rely on dimension and type of magnetic ions, as predicted by the models, and probably depends also on the shape, for sure, of magnetic nanoparticles, and this influence must be studied by many other cases, many other types of nanoparticles. And we can say that the surface spin's coating effect is still unexplored. The fact that we are not able to fit with the same parameter R1 and R2 means that in the model probably are missed some other mechanisms that can be involved in the relaxation, nuclear relaxation of the nanoparticles. One of these mechanisms can be also, for instance, the inter-particle interaction. And so what we need for the future are other specific model that try to interpret so complex multifunctional magnetic nanomaterials. Today I present you only the in vitro results obtained these years, but in principle for the application we need to observe also the in vivo situation, but this is completely another story, and so today we don't have enough time to discuss about this. Thank you for your attention.